Innanzitutto grazie mille per l'invito, sono veramente onorata di essere qui. E volevo anche dire che poiché sono 21 anni che sono via dall'Italia, scientificamente almeno, il mio italiano scientifico è piuttosto rudimentale e preferirei parlare in inglese, sì? Okay, yes. No, the idea is to speak in English. So let me actually start with an outline of the lectures. So the first one of today, this morning, will focus on the modeling of the dynamics and the gravitational wave emission from compact object binaries, and in particular binary black holes. I will also talk about, of course, the discovery by LIGO and then Virgo. I will then switch to the most recent discovery of binary neutron stars and all the multi-messenger signatures that we have observed through the astronomical telescopes. This will be the topic of this afternoon. The third lecture of tomorrow, I call it The Bright Future of Gravitational Wave Astronomy. The idea was to try to tell you what will happen next, not just in the next few years, but in the next 10-15 years. There is already a plan for the next generation of detectors on the ground and also in space. But I also want to say that because there is a lot of material in these two lectures, I'm sure that some of them will also go in the third one. So we'll see how it, you know, how it will work. And I wanted also to emphasize that in Germany, there was a stamp that was produced on the 7th of December, celebrating actually the first discovery of gravitational waves. This is also quite exciting, I think. Okay, so let me start with the first lecture, the outline of the first lecture. I also want to say that I think it will be very good if you ask questions during the lecture and not wait just to the end. I think we'll create more interaction and maybe more useful for you and also for me. So I will start reviewing some really basic facts of gravitational waves. I didn't know the knowledge and the expertise of the people in the audience, so I will start with some basic features of gravitational emission. I will then actually focus, this will happen actually over all the lecture, on the binary black holes that have been discovered by LIGO and Virgo, and I will try to focus from a scientific point of view on the science that we have extracted on the astrophysics and fundamental physics information that we have been able to extract until now, and also the test of general relativity that we have done until now. Now, in order actually to discuss this, I have to tell you about the theoretical groundwork that has been developed during the last 20-30 years that was crucial to detect the signal, identify them, and also extract scientific information, astrophysics and fundamental physics. And in particular, the modeling of the dynamics and the gravitational wave emission using mainly two methods, one that I call analytical relativity and the other one numerical relativity, and the interface between these two methods that have been crucial because you will see Einstein equations are very complicated and complex. There is no exact solution of what we call the two-body problem in general relativity, which is the problem of solving the dynamics and the gravitational wave emission from binary black holes, neutron stars, etc. I will also focus at some point in the talk on this approach, which is called effective one-body theory, which have been very much involved, which is an analytical approach which also uses information from numerical relativity, which it's able actually to put together perturbation results, strong field results, and also offer a method to actually guess and describe a semi-analytical, also the most non-linear part of the signal, which is the merger part. And I will also discuss, if there is time, future challenging in the source modeling. Okay, so let me start with reviewing some key ideas of that actually make the difference between gravity as we have learned it in Newtonian physics, Newtonian gravity, and general relativity. So Newtonian gravity is what we are more used to, what we learn in our classes in classical mechanics. Is the force that governs the motion of the planets around the sun, the motion of the projectile that you send on the Earth. And although perhaps you cannot really see the plot here, there is just a grid, a two-dimensional grid. So in Newtonian gravity, space and time, as we used to say, are given a priori. They are not influenced by the presence of energy and the mass that is present. And also time is absolute, it flows at the same rate everywhere and always. Now this concept changed in the theory of general relativity that was put out by Einstein in 1915, where space-time became a dynamic and an elastic entity that can be influenced and is influencing the distribution of mass and the energy that it contains. And in fact, gravity in the theory of Einstein becomes a geometric gravity. And what this means, just to explain in a few words again, I'm sorry, perhaps you don't see very well. I don't know if we can lower a little bit actually the light in the room, perhaps. So what you see here are two, let's say, bodies, A and B, that moves along trajectories that perhaps you don't see very well in green. And because the two trajectories bend, we say that there is a force between the two bodies, and the two bodies anyway move along the straightest possible lines. This is what we learn also in our courses in classical mechanics or physics one, I guess. Now, if on the other hand, as you can see here, so in this plot here, the two lines are straight, if you can see them. In this plot, on the other hand, the two curves actually are bending. So there could be two possible explanations of the fact that the curves are bending. So Newton would say that there is a force between the two bodies, and that's the reason why they don't move along the straightest possible lines. Einstein, on the other hand, would say, could interpret this as, no, actually there are no forces between the two bodies. They still move along the straightest possible line, but not on a sphere, but on a plane. And so this is just a way of understanding that in the theory of gravity by Einstein, gravity becomes geometric, you have to interpret it in a geometric way. Gravity is the effect of the curvature, of the warping of the geometry of space-time. So if you consider, for example, the Sun and the Earth, the Sun is still moving along the straightest possible line, but the straightest possible line here, because the space-time is curved, is not actually a straight line as we would imagine in Euclidean geometry, but is going to be a circle or an ellipse in the case of the Earth going around the Sun. Okay, so now considering that the space-time is no longer something which is given a priori, which is there, not moving, it can be warped. It's not unusual to think that in this space-time, the perturbation, fluctuation that are produced by the variation in time or in space of the space-time itself, that produce, in fact, what we call waves, gravitational waves. So they were actually predicted by Einstein in 1916, and they were derived by Einstein by linearizing the Einstein equation that I wrote down here, R mu nu minus 1 half G mu nu, which is the metric of the space-time, and the R. And on the right-hand side, you have a G, the Newton constant, C, the speed of light, and T mu nu is the energy momentum tensor. So if you write the metric as like flat spacetime or Minkowski metric plus a very small perturbation, and you linearize this equation and you are in a particular gauge, the so-called Lorentz gauge, this is just the D'Alembert operator, in this particular gauge the equation resembles the equation of electromagnetism, in fact, in the Lorentz gauge, where here you would have the current G mu nu, but now you have the energy momentum tensor of the source. And now if you have, in fact, a distribution of mass that deforms the space-time in its neighborhood, these deformations, they just propagate away, they go at the speed of light, and they can vary, they can oscillate, reflecting the variation in time of the distribution of the matter that has produced them. This is a still picture of a movie that I will show you later, which represent actually two little black holes that go around each other here and produce this particular pattern of waves that then propagate away, as I said, at the speed of light. The waves come in two different polarizations that we call the plus and the cross polarization. So we have two radiative degrees of freedom. Again, if you think about the analogy with electromagnetism, also there you have two polarizations. Here, the polarization, as I said, are called the plus and cross. So I want to just spend a minute saying that. There was a first paper by Einstein, and I have here just a reproduction of the first part of the paper, where Einstein actually derived in 1916 the equation. Basically, he did this linearization of the equation. And I want to say two things. So first, actually, there was, I think everybody perhaps knows, there was actually a mistake in the first paper by Einstein. He messed up, actually. He didn't get correctly the right degrees of freedom, actually, for the gravitational waves. He didn't get that the equation would be transversal. But that doesn't matter, okay, too much. I wanted just to actually emphasize the fact that he was pointing out in this first paper that the equation, the amplitude of the equation, would be basically negligible to be seen ever. And in fact, these equations predict actually that the waves are very weak. And it took many years. First of all, it took a long time also to understand which kind of system could produce waves that we could detect. And also the technology, it took a long time to develop the right technology actually to detect these waves. But you know, in 1916, this was a long time ago, it was certainly not clear that one day, you know, the technology would have been developed to do that. The other thing I wanted to say is that there was actually another paper written by Einstein himself 2 years afterwards, in 1918, where actually he corrected the mistake that he did in the first paper. So in the second paper he got the equation right, he got the so-called quadruple formula that the waves would be produced by the variation in time of the quadruple of the system, of the source. He had another small mistake, just a factor two at the end of the calculation, but again that doesn't matter really. You know, we are in 2018, so it took actually a long time, a long history, but it was at the end, this very successful. Okay, so let me start by telling you actually some features of these gravitational waves. So, first of all, they are produced by sources that are dominated by gravity. And as I anticipated just a minute ago, they are actually produced by the variation in time of the quadruple moment of the source. So if Hij is the gravitational wave, which is dimensionless, it's just an order of magnitude, is actually proportional to g divided by c to the 4, the second derivative of the quadruple moment of the source. So if you have an object which is just spherically symmetric, it's not going to produce gravitational waves. So if you take the Earth, which as you know has some bumps on it, the motion of the Earth would produce actually the rotation of the Earth around its axis would produce gravitational waves. They are also inversely proportional to the distance to the source, which means if the waves are very far from us, if the source, sorry, is very far from us, the waves are going to be weaker and weaker, okay? That's why it's very important that the system, the source, is very close to the Earth. But of course, if you want to detect, for example, the collision of two black holes, you have also to count how many of these collisions there are in a certain volume, and there are more if the volume is bigger. So if you are very far from the Earth, you will have more events, but you will lose in amplitude. So now the typical strength, forget now about the indices I and J of the wave, so let's call it like just H. Now, the second derivative of the quadrupole, if you think about what is the quadrupole would be the mass multiplied by the characteristic length of the source square, mR square, okay? So if you now take two time derivatives, there will be a frequency square, so that you can trade as 1 over the period square, and you can very easily show, just doing some simple math, that actually the second derivative of the quadrupole is at the end proportional to the kinetic energy of the object divided by c square. And because you are looking at deviation from spherical symmetry, let's call the parameter that describes this deviation from spherical symmetry as epsilon. So epsilon can be, 1%, 10%, something. Maybe in the most, extreme case will be something of the order of 1. Now, if you assume that some solar masses is emitted in gravitational waves, so E kinetic divided by C square, a few solar masses, you end up with H, which is of the order of something like 10 to the minus 22, 21, depending on the distance. If you are at a few megaparsec, you can get of the order of 10 to the minus 22, a very tiny number. You can also get the gravitational wave luminosity of power by basically taking one derivative of H and squaring it. You have the luminosity, which for a binary system you can derive. It is actually proportional to the velocity of the binary divided by the speed of light to a very high power, to the power 10 at leading order. Now notice that this term here, C to the 5 divided by G, it's enormous. It's 10 to the 59 erg per second, okay? So if you want to have a very large luminosity, you have to have a speed which is very close to the speed of light, because if you have just a fraction of the speed of light, suppose 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 5, which is actually the velocity with which the planets go around the sun, because this is at the power 10, you can reduce this overall power by a huge amount. So this means that if you really want to have a large luminosity, you have to have basically objects that go almost at the speed of light. And to bring objects at the speed of light, you have to have objects that are very compact, that they don't break, because otherwise they are going basically to just disrupt before coming at a very large speed. That's why we will know, as you will see, objects like black holes or neutron stars. Now, this actually power is similar or larger, if you put here V over C of the order of 1 and you consider 10 to the 59 erg per second, this is similar or larger than the one of the whole visible universe. So it's a huge actually luminosity, but it's going to be emitted in a very short amount of time, in a fraction of a second, a few seconds. We will see later today, in a few minutes, in the case of a binary neutron star. Now, another thing I wanted to point out is that, so I said at the beginning, this was the reason why Einstein thought we will never detect gravitational waves. Gravitational waves are very weak, and they are so weak that it's difficult to detect them, but also means that they are almost unaffected by the matter and the energy that they carry, that they can encounter as they travel from the matter, from the source, to the Earth. And so they can be considered as pristine probes. So this is crucial, because this means that the waves can have, that they carry fingerprints of the source that has generated them,
And so because they are not much affected by whatever they encounter, we can actually extract unique information from these waves if we can reproduce theoretically, if we know how to describe this, the shape of these waves.
Okay, so let's move on. I want to add something about the fact that, as I said, the waves are proportional to the variation in time of the quadrupole. Actually, if you do more calculation, you can actually determine, as you would do in electromagnetism, if you study, for example, the wave, the electromagnetic wave, away from a source, you can actually derive an expansion. This is done actually at linear order in G, because actually the Einstein equation are non-linear. This is not the end of the story, because at some point you will have a correction that square with that goes like g square, g cube, etc. So this expansion that I wrote on the slide is valid only at linear order in G, but it's as you can see, it's proportional to 1 over d, and then you have all power in C, and this is proportional to different multiple moments. So the leading multiple moment linear in G is the quadrupole, as I was saying, and then you will have the current quadrupole. This is the mass quadrupole, and then you start having the octupole, etc. So I wanted just to spend 1 minute in explaining why actually at linear order in G we don't have, for example, the dipole or even the monopole as the first term in this expansion when you produce gravitational waves. And the reason is because if you compute the dipole in the case of gravity, so in electromagnetism this will be the sum of the charges, the electric charges multiplied by x, the position of the charge with respect, for example, to the center of mass of the system. Now, in gravity, this is going to be the mass instead of the electric charge. And if you take one derivative, you get basically the momentum. And so if you take two time derivatives, you will get, so if you take actually one time derivative, you will get the variation of the momentum. But at linear order in G, the momentum is actually constant, because this is just the conservation of the total momentum of the system. Of course, this is no longer true if you take into account correction that are higher order in G, but it's going to be true at linear order in G. And the same argument can be actually extended to not the electric dipole moment or the mass dipole moment, but to the current dipole moment in the case of gravity, where you will have actually the angular momentum. For the same reason, if you take one derivative of the angular momentum, it's actually zero at linear order in G. So that explains actually in a very naive way why actually the first multiple moment is actually the quadrupole. Okay, so now I want to say something about the fact that, as I was explaining in this slide, because we need to reach a very high speed, we need objects that are very strong, they have very strong gravity, and they are compact. So black holes are very good candidates. So for people in the audience who don't know what are black holes, so a black hole is actually an object which is made of just warp space and time. There is no matter. Light or anything else can escape the black hole horizon. And now, just to give you an idea, if you take a black hole which has a mass of 10 solar masses, the radius of the black hole, which is basically the horizon, it's around 30 kilometers for a black hole which is not rotating. Now, just to give you a term of comparison, if you take, for example, the Sun, which has the mass of the Sun, so we have a radius of 700,000 kilometers. So by compact, we mean that basically the mass divided by the radius is actually very close to, in the case of a black hole, is 0.5, so it's quite large. For the Sun, this ratio is going to be of the order of 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 3. So a black hole is very compact. It curves and bends the geometry around it. This is a picture that shows, in fact, a black hole and the light that comes from stars around that are bended. And in fact, the geometry around the black hole, for students here, who have taken classes not in general relativity, you might be interested in knowing that if you compute the circumference very close to the horizon of a black hole, it's no longer true that the circumference is just equal to the radius multiplied by 2 pi. Moreover, so gravity is quite strong around the horizon of the black hole and becomes stronger and stronger as you actually fall into the black hole and if you approach the singularity.
But in this talk, I'm not going to, and in the next talks, I'm not going to describe what happened inside the black hole, because as you are going to see, when two black holes merge, they will form a new black hole. And so the physics we are going to be interested in is actually at most the physics very close to the horizon of the black hole. And it's going to be all the time just classical gravity. So not, we are not going to describe what happened very close to the singularity, where perhaps, you know, we have to care about quantum gravity effects. But, you know, there are also people and models suggesting that perhaps quantum gravity could be modified at the level of the horizon, but this is not what we are going to describe here. Now, before, in fact, describing gravitational waves, what did we know about black holes before actually the detection through gravitational waves? So in the 70s, the first actually X-ray binary system composed of one black hole was discovered. This source is called Cygnus X1. It's actually a binary system with a supergiant star that goes around what we think is a black hole. And because the material falls into the black hole and it's heated up, it emits X-ray. So this was discovered in the 60s. Moreover, starting from the 70s, from the radio emission, we actually know that there is a huge object that we think is a black hole at the center of our own galaxy, made of something like 4 million times the mass of the Sun. And what you see here through the emission and the radio emission, you see actually how people have been able to monitor the motion of some stars around Sagittarius A star, starting from, this movie was from 2000 up to 2014, in fact, almost. So applying actually the Kepler law, for people here that have studied classical mechanics, we use actually the Kepler law to determine what is the mass of the object at the center, in the same way actually that was applied in this system and was obtained the mass of the candidate black hole. It's around 10, 11, 12 solar masses. And here is 4 million times the mass of the Sun. So, to discover binary black holes and to discover actually that really that black hole exists, because this is the most direct way to know that black hole exists, we had to do it through gravitational waves. And this is a beautiful movie done by the Simulating Extreme Spacetime Collaboration that shows, in fact, the binary black hole that was actually with a parameter discovered by LIGO in the first detection. And only through gravitational waves we can know about black holes directly, because they don't emit any light, at least stellar mass black holes, okay? Supermassive black holes that perhaps a space-based detector like LISA will discover in the future may have matter around, and they may produce also electromagnetic counterparts. But stellar mass black hole, by which I mean masses between few masses up to 30, 40 solar masses, are supposed to have no matter around. Okay, the other important thing before talking about LIGO and Virgo is what we knew about gravitational waves before we discovered them with LIGO
in 1915. So we knew about the existence of gravitational waves through so-called binary pulsar. And this is just an animation of a pulsar, which is a highly magnetized neutron star, which can emit beam of radiation in the radio. And in 24, a binary composed of two neutron stars was discovered. And this is just the movie that represents it. The first binary pulsar was discovered actually by Alston Taylor in the 70s, and they got the Nobel Prize in 1993. Now, why we bother about them? Because the pulsar emits
actually radio pulses that we detect on the Earth.
So they are represented by this profile here. Now, if the pulsar is part of a binary system, the pulse, which
is emitted every time the pulsar rotates and the beam encounters the Earth,
if it is in a binary system, the pulse doesn't arrive on the Earth always at the same time,
but it's a little bit shifted because the pulsar is in a binary and is moving around the other object.
And by monitoring with very, very high accuracy
the shift of the time of pulses that arrive on the Earth,
people have been able basically to make a plot like this, which is the cumulative shift of the periastron time due to the fact that this is explained as due to the shrinkage of the orbit, because the system is emitting gravitational waves.
So because the total energy of the system has to be conserved, the waves bring away from the system energy, and so the orbit basically shrinks over time.
And this is the effect that you see here. If there was no emission of gravitational waves, this would be just zero all the time, over time. You know, this is 2004, the year this binary was discovered, up to almost today. And these are actually the data with their error, amazing actually precision. And the red curve is not a fit, it's the prediction from actually
the Einstein theory of general relativity, from the quadruple formula that I've been describing to you.
So the agreement is unbelievable.
And this was actually a proof before LIGO made the first detection that gravitational waves existed. But this was not a wave that passed through the Earth. So we detected it by this change of the orbital evolution through the pulses, the radio pulses that we detect on the Earth.
So today we have actually started to see what we call the transient and persistent gravitational wave sky. So we have interferometers and experiments that are actually spanning a very large region of frequency. So at high frequency we have LIGO and Virgo. At very low frequency, 10 to the minus 9 Hz, we have today actually way of detecting gravitational waves through pulsars, more than one, actually many of them. It's a pulsar timing array. In the future, between these two bandwidths, 10 to the minus 9 and 10 to the 3, we will have a detector in space that is called LISA. Now, the main sources, the most promising, are binary black holes, binary neutron stars, and they can last in the detectors for different times depending on the bandwidth of the detectors. Tens of milliseconds, minutes in the case of LIGO Virgo. For LISA, or next generation of detectors on the ground that we call Einstein telescope, months and years. They will appear as continuous signals in detectors like the pulsar timing array, and they will form, in fact, a stochastic background of gravitational waves. Now, in my talk, at least today and part of tomorrow, I will mainly focus on binary systems, but tomorrow I will also mention other, actually, gravitational wave sources, supernovae that produce bursts of radiation lasting for tens of milliseconds, and also pulsars.
So I just talked about pulsar. If a pulsar has some mountains on this crust, and I'm talking about mountains of a height of a few centimeters, because that's allowed, the only thing that is allowed on actually because of the very strong gravitational force on a pulsar,
because they rotate, they can emit gravitational waves, and they are periodic signals. And tomorrow we will see also that from the very early universe, from inflation and other mechanisms in the early universe, we can produce, gravitational waves could have been produced, generating a stochastic background of gravitational waves that could be detected in the future. So just this is just a glimpse, a snapshot of the different sources. Let me now start with the detectors. So, as you know, we have two LIGO detectors in the US that have been operating since 2004 in the first configuration. Virgo, that operated also starting from 2007 and then went through an upgrade. They came back online in August 2017. There is the British-German detector in Germany, in Hannover, called GEO-600. LIGO India is planned for the next 4 or 5 years, and we have a detector also under construction in Japan, which is called KAGRA. There is a collaboration which is called the LIGO Scientific Collaboration of about 800 members. Here you see the LIGOs. There is also the Virgo collaboration. Together they form a collaboration of about 1,000 members. I put just two slides because I want just briefly to also highlight some milestones that went in building these detectors, starting from the pioneer work of Joe Weber at the University of Maryland, who built the first bar detectors. This happened in the 1960s. He also claimed to have actually detected gravitational waves, but this was not confirmed by other bars, in particular by the group in Germany led by Heinz Billing. In 1967, there was the first ideas of actually build more larger detector, more sensitive detector by Ray Weiss. The story for LIGO went that around 1989 there was the first proposal submitted to NSF fund LIGO by Ray Weiss, Kip Thorne and Ron Driver under the directorship of Vogt at Caltech. And only in 1994 LIGO was funded at a low level, but then it became really the largest funded NSF project only in 1994 under the directorship of Barry Barish. As you know, this last year actually, Thorne, Weiss and Barish got the Nobel Prize for for the LIGO discovery. Now, LIGO ended the construction at the beginning of 2000. The first runs started in 2004, and in 2015 there was the upgrade to advanced LIGO. Now, this is the story from an experimental point of view. From a theoretical point of view, was very important also, as we will see quite a lot later, to the story of solving the Einstein equation and predicting the shape of the gravitational waves. Now, I want to say something also about Virgo, the Virgo actually was approved by CNRS first and then the year after by INFM in 1994. EGO, the European Gravitational Observatory, was created around 2000. Virgo took the first data in 2007, unless I made a mistake. It was operating for a few years and then was upgraded to advanced Virgo, as I said, in August 2017. I also want to emphasize that, of course, in Italy there have been also development of bar detectors that operated for several years in Rome and also in Padova, and one of the bars was also maybe even two in at CERN in Geneva. By the way, at some point someone has to tell me that the first 45 minutes ended because I can continue to...
You have another 6 or 7 minutes.
Okay, for the first part. Okay, so let me go quickly about this. So just a few words about the interferometer. So these are the two pictures of the LIGO and Virgo interferometer. And this is a scheme of the interferometer.
So I want to say that for people here that perhaps are not or are used more to you know, astronomy, we don't collect the fluxes of gravitational waves. The way in which we detect gravitational waves, we use the key idea is the way in which gravitational waves interact with free bodies. And this is just a representation of a ring of particles that is free of moving. And if you consider a gravitational wave that impinges the screen perpendicularly, this particle would be put in motion in this way. So now, if you think about the interferometer with the mirrors that hang by wire at the extremity of the interferometer, and you have a gravitational wave that impinges perpendicular to the plane that contains the cavities and the mirrors, they would move, stretch, and squeeze. Actually, it's the proper distance that will change. And so the separation between the mirrors will change. And we use an optical configuration such that if the lengths are the same in the two cavities, there is no light that goes out from the beam splitter. But if this changes, if there is a differential change in the distance between the mirrors, then some light leaks out from the dark part. And this is what we collect here. Now, we monitor phase shifts of light of the order of 10 to the minus 9 radians. And now, if you remember that H dimensionless quantity that I have in one of my previous slides at the beginning of the talk, that was H, that H is proportional to delta L, the variation of this, the length in the interferometer divided by the length itself. And we basically measure variation of the order of 10 to the minus 16 centimeter. And if you consider 4 kilometers the length of the cavity, we are basically monitoring, we are basically probing H at the level of 10 to the minus 21, which is also what you see here. This is the noise spectral density of the detector in 1 over square root of Hz as a function of the frequency for the two LIGO detectors. And if you multiply this by the square root of the bandwidth, you get something of the order of 10 to the minus 21, 10 to the minus 22. Okay, this was a movie that represents actually what I just said. This is the light that goes in the two cavities of the interferometer. Okay, this is just zooming in. So this is the light that goes back and forth between the two mirrors. Actually, in this animation, there is no Fabry Perot cavity, so you don't see, you know, the mirrors here. And now, if the length is the same, you don't have light that comes out from the beam splitter. But if now the length between the two mirrors, you know, changes, then some light can leak out from here. This is just a snapshot of, some pictures inside the LIGO facility, just to show you the mirrors. These are really amazing objects. They have a weight around 30 kilos, I believe. And they are made of sapphire, which is very important in order to reduce the thermal noise. These are the vacuum chamber. So the vacuum actually inside the mirrors, these are the baffles that are important to reduce the scatter light. And in fact, just one word about the typical noise inside the interferometer. So this is the typical noise curve as a function of the frequency, the noise spectral density, you know, of the detector. So we are actually dominated also in the second generation of detectors. The seismic noise at low frequency, shot noise at high frequency, and thermal noise in this intermediate region here. In the future, we will dominate it also by radiation pressure, gravity gradient noise, etc. Okay, now let me go to the next slide. Yeah, because I wanted actually still to say something about what actually was really crucial to go from initial LIGO to advanced LIGO. And I talk here about LIGO because I'm referring here to the first detection in 2015, where Virgo was not yet operational.
So this is the noise curve actually of initial LIGO, okay, in green. And the improved sensitivity, which really made, was very important for the detection because it was crucial for the binary black hole observation, is here at low frequency. And this big improvement at low frequency was due to the seismic isolation system, which was improved, and also to the, particularly the thermal noise coming from the suspension system developed in Glasgow. But also the active seismic isolation system that was developed, I believe, in Stanford in the US, that really improved the sensitivity here. And you will see that, in fact, binary black holes merge the one that we observe in the hundreds of Hertz. And so you have to accumulate some signal-to-noise ratio in this region here. Of course, also the improvement at high frequency was important, but this is mainly due to the increase of the laser power inside the arm cavity. Okay, let's go, before we finish, let's at least go to the first discovery, and actually during the first observing run. So what you see here in these two plots is just to highlight the differences between the first observation of the binary black hole, what we call gravitational wave 150914, that stands for 2015 September, the 14th of September, and the second one that happened on the 26th of December 2015. So on the low upper panel, you see the signal actually after just applying a filter to remove noise actually below 30 Hz and above 400 Hz in Hanford and Livingston, and then shifting the Hanford by the time of travel between the two detectors. So you see basically the two signals coincide besides small differences because they are not just, they don't perfectly align with each other, the two detectors. In the second panel here, you see the reconstructed signal with templates and wavelets in gray, and also a signal produced by a numerical relativity simulation of a binary black hole in red and in blue. Subtracting the template or the signal from the noise, you see basically Gaussian noise here. And this is another way of representing the signal in frequency time. You see the so-called chirp. The frequency increases as a function of time because the system is losing energy as it emits gravitational waves. It goes faster and faster, and so the frequency, like in the Hals-Taylor binary that I showed you before, and then up to merger, where you have the peak of the luminosity. The first event was loud, very loud. It lasted 10 cycles and 0.2 seconds. The second event, as you can see here, was actually quieter. Was longer, it lasted almost 1 second, and in fact you cannot see it by eye. We needed a so-called match filtering or signal processing to dig out the signal from the noise. Even in the frequency time plot, you don't see much. Okay, and the big discovery had a splash on the news, also in the Italian newspapers, German in the US. I like a lot this picture from the New Yorker. Was that I heard just now, OSI 2 black holes colliding, because the signal is called, a chirp. So I think I stop here, and then I will, should I stop here, the first 45? Okay, so I stop here, and we will continue now more with the science, and actually a few other detection, binary black holes, and then the modeling, okay, in the second part. And if there are questions also.
We have a first question session, then coffee break, and then the second half of the lecture. So questions from...
Yeah.
Please,
okay. Just a question. You did a nice model to compare the density of the compact black hole. Just a number, I mean.
The compactness.
Relative to the nuclear matter.
But nuclear matter, you mean the compactness, or what do you mean?
The black density of a black hole compared to the density of the nuclear matter.
Well, I can tell you the density we will arrive at this afternoon of a bind of a neutron star. So a neutron star, the density is 10 to the 14, larger than 10 to the 14 gram per centimeter cube. And the one in the sun, for example, it's 1 gram per centimeter cube. Okay? Nuclear density, it's around 10 to the 14 gram per centimeter cube. So a neutron star is maybe 10 times larger than nuclear density. Now, for the black hole, I have a problem because, you know, there is no really matter in the black hole, so I don't think I can talk about density. We generally talk about compactness, which is just the mass divided by the radius. But that, you know, is not, we are not talking about gram centimeter cube, it's just, in fact, it's a dimensionless quantity. It's 0.5 for black holes, and it's 10 to the minus 4 for the sun, which is very small. Okay?
Do you use thermal noise? Do they use cooling?
Yeah, so no, the thermal noise of the suspension it uses actually particular material and monolithic suspensions. That was crucial, but I'm talking about the thermal noise of the suspension system. Now, the Kagra detector in Japan is quite interesting because for the first time will be cryogenic. We'll use cryogenic techniques for the to reduce the thermal noise of the mirror itself. So that will be the first time and will be important because as we move to more sensitive detectors, I wanted to come back to the plot of this plot here, sorry, yeah. So as we actually go to next generation of detectors, actually even advanced LIGO, the thermal you see is here, but at some point that we encounter the test mass internal, I mean, the thermal noise of the test masses, which will appear here. And if we want to improve the sensitivity in the future, we have to cope with this thermal noise of the mirror. And the Kagra detector is trying to address this problem in using cryogenic techniques. But people are also proposing other materials to reduce, to change the coating. I'm sure that here the Virgo people may know quite well, even more than me, about this. So if they want to comment.
Yeah, maybe I can add something. There are a lot of studies about the material composing the test masses. There are people that are studying test masses not made of silicon oxide, but by silicon itself. So the future interferometers, maybe they will operate in a different wavelength and so on. There are a lot of studies in different parts of the countries involved in this kind of research. So
work is in progress. It's very important for the future detectors. Any other question? Okay.
Now we can resume. Just a technical detail for questions. You're welcome to use this microphone. So I appear to lecture. All those who want to ask questions, I will repeat.
Okay, so do you hear me? No. Do you hear me now? There is no light.
Try now.
Do you hear me now? Do you hear? But yours was working.
But it's close. I think it's close.
No, I moved.
Oh, prova.
Prova.
Prova. Prova, prova.
Prova. I think we can continue with the other one, with the one that I was using. I think it's okay. I don't, it's not a problem.
Won't you do this one?
But it's complicated with this thing here.
Yeah. No. Oh, so?
Ah, okay.
So, you're in the pocket.
Can you switch on? Do you hear me better now? Do you hear me?
Now?
Can you? Hello? But is it on, actually? Hello? Yeah, it's not working, actually. I think I would suggest that we go back to...
Okay.
You see, it's not working.
Session 26. Right now?
No. Oh, let's...
No,
because otherwise...
I'm sorry, but...
Yeah, don't worry. Okay. So we go back to this one. Okay, so we'll start again. Yes, so I was describing the first two events very quickly. I want to now move on and give you some other information about the other events that we detected, and we move to the modeling part. So this event actually was, so after the first observing run, which lasted for 3-4 months between 2015 and the beginning of 2016, LIGO started the second observing run in November 2016. And in January, there was another observation which was another binary black hole called 170104, was similar actually to the first event in terms of the masses, as you will see also later. And I'm just putting here the frequency time plot and the reconstructing actually the data of Enford and Livingston in after shifting by the time of arrival. And superimpose is the reconstructed signal, the best fit with the model that I will describe in a moment. Okay, moving on. Advanced Virgo came online and joined LIGO on August 1st, 2017. And you can see here the noise curve of Virgo at the time, at least you know, taken from this paper of September. And this was quite amazing. In fact, after just 2 weeks from the time Virgo joined the network, there was on the 14th of August 2017 a detection of another binary black hole with the three detectors, Enford, Livingston, and you see here Virgo. Because Virgo had lower sensitivity, as you have seen just from the plot I showed you of the noise spectral density here, the signal-to-noise ratio was smaller with respect to the one of the two LIGO detector, but still was enough to, you know, participate to the observation of this other binary black hole. And then there was the big result just 3 days afterwards. In fact, the 17th of August 2017. We discovered the first binary neutron star. I will describe a lot about this in the afternoon, so I want just to show you here the time frequency plots for the LIGO, Enford, LIGO, Livingston, and Virgo. This signal was really strong, even stronger than the first binary black hole discovered by LIGO. And also it lasted much longer, in fact, starting from 30 Hertz, 1 minute. And you will see also later, depending on the mass of the signal can last in band for different times. So the larger is the mass, the lower is the frequency at which the merger happens, and so the signal starting from 30 Hertz is shorter. That's why it lasts for a fraction of a second for binary black holes, and it's just 10, 15 cycles, and here you can have something like 3,000 cycles in band. Okay. So we are building a population of binary black holes. You see here in this plot the masses. Actually, what is represented here, it's you know, you have the two component masses objects that then form a new black hole. So the two and form a new black hole, etc. In violet, there are actually masses of black holes from X-ray binaries. You remember at some point I was talking about Cygnus X1, which was the first X-ray binary discovered, which had a black hole. So today we know more, and these are the masses of this of the black holes in X-ray binaries. We don't know, theoretically, people expect that there is a mass gap between the lowest mass of the black hole, perhaps 5 solar masses, and the maximum mass of a neutron star, which is around 2 solar masses, actually it could be even 3 solar masses. And so you see here actually the two neutron stars that form a new neutron, actually we think it's more a black hole, in the binary neutron star gravitational wave 170817 that I just described before. Okay. And in fact, just talking about this number of cycles, there is this very nice animation that puts together, except for this last source, the length of the different binary black hole waveforms that have been discovered. This actually was more a trigger, didn't reach a high statistical significance to claim a detection, but it's also there. And here you see the neutron star, which is still going because it's very long. And as I was saying, really it's the total mass of the binary system together with the mass ratio that determines the number of cycles in band. And for neutron stars, because we expect that the single mass is not going to be larger than 2 solar masses, the total mass of the neutron star is quite small. And in fact, the neutron star binary also merge at much higher frequency in the kilohertz. Okay, so now let's start discussing more the features of the waveform and the modeling. So first of all, we generally represent the waveform as composed by what we call the spiral part. In fact, the waveform is emitted for a very long time. The binary lasts for millions of years, tens of millions of years. It's just that when the two systems go around each other at larger separation, the gravitational wave that they emit is too low frequency to be seen in the bandwidth of the LIGO detector or Virgo detector. And also, if the separation is quite large, the signal is very weak. So the binary black holes that we have seen, they have maybe 10, 15, or 55 gravitational wave cycles, and then they plunge, the two black holes plunge, they form, they merge together, and they form a new black hole, and the black hole is like a bell. It has its own proper frequencies that depends on the mass and the spin of the black hole. Not the charge, because stellar mass black hole are supposed to be non-charged, they don't have a charge, so only the mass and the spin. And during this phase, we call it this phase ring down, because the quasi-normal mode have a real and imaginary part for the frequency. So as it settles to the stationary configuration, the black hole basically ring down.
But this is the merger where all the nonlinearities of general relativity you know, become very, very important. Now, what you see here is the velocity divided by the speed of light of the binary. In green, it increases, and so V over C becomes very large, very close to merger. And the two black holes, in this particular case, which was the first detection, have a radius, because the masses were around 30 solar masses. I was telling you, if the black hole has a mass of 30 solar masses, the radius is 30, it's 90 kilometers. And they are close to merger at a separation of 350 kilometers, and they are making something like 75 orbits per second. So they are acting really like particles in an accelerator, like the LHC, but these are macroscopic objects, these are black holes, okay? It's quite amazing. So now, if we can track the phase and the amplitude evolution with very high accuracy, we can actually extract unique information. So we need to have this very good description of the waveform. So I want to start with a few equations just to show you, in fact, that some information can be captured just using very basic formula in Newtonian gravity and the so-called quadrupole formula, okay? The emission of gravitational wave to the quadrupole. And let's go through this exercise. It's very simple. So if you introduce the mass of the two objects, M1 and M2, and you have the total mass of the binary, then you introduce the reduced mass. So think about the Newtonian gravity problem that you study in classical mechanics. So this is the reduced mass. And this is a dimensionless quantity, the reduced mass divided by the total mass. This dimensionless quantity varies between 0 and 1/4. Equal mass is 1/4. If one mass is much larger than the other, is 0. Now, if you take the quadrupole formula, so the emission or the luminosity as a function of the third time, the derivative of the quadrupole, and you work out the exercise, what is the quadrupole for a binary, you derive this very simple formula at leading order that connects the combination of the masses, the dimensional reduced mass, the total mass, in a quantity that we call the chief mass. It connects it to the frequency of the gravitational wave, F, and the first derivative of the frequency, to a certain power, and there are some coefficients, doesn't matter. But now, if from the data you can extract the frequency evolution and the first derivative of the frequency, and we can do that even for the first detection, just looking at the data, the data of the this plot that I was showing you of the time frequency plots, even from this time frequency plot, you can derive, F dot and F. Sorry, I have to go again here. You can actually determine the chief mass. The chief mass was 30 solar masses for the first event. Now, because of this dependence on nu, and nu being between 0 and 1/4, you can derive that the total mass has to be larger than 70 solar masses.
So this is already tells you that the two objects cannot be two neutron stars, because I was telling you that the neutron stars have a smaller mass. They can have the largest mass they can have is 2-3 solar masses.
So already from this calculation, you know that there should be at least one of the two objects has to be a black hole. Now, if you take the Newtonian law, which says that V square is equal to gm over r, I put g equal to 1 in this formula, but it's gm over r, and you write v square like omega square r square, because the two objects, you can assume they are moving on a circular orbit. Omega is the angular frequency. The gravitational wave frequency is twice that. So at the peak of the luminosity, which is 150 Hz, you can determine the separation, which is 350 kilometers.
And now, if you put two black holes, which have a certain Schwarzschild radius, the horizon, you can put two black holes within a radius of 350 kilometers. So this was this again. It's a calculation that allows you to basically conclude that the two objects have to be compact. You cannot take a normal star. I told you a normal star like the star, the Sun, has a radius of 700,000 kilometers. So normal stars are not compact enough to put them inside, you know, a radius of 350 kilometers. But you can put two black holes. Could a system be formed by a neutron star black hole? Well, if you take the mass of the neutron star to be the maximum one, then because they have to satisfy this Chirp mass, the black hole mass has to be very large, 2,000 almost solar masses, which means it will be much larger, the radius, and you cannot put it within this kilometer. So this calculation already tells you, again, that the two objects have to be black holes. But it's not a proof that they are black holes, okay? Because to prove that they are black holes, you have to show that they have an horizon, or you have to show more, you have to show that they satisfy, you know, the Einstein equation, I mean, the theory of general relativity for Kerr black holes. But this is a back of the envelope calculation that hints in that direction. Okay, so now let's now move more on, sorry, why didn't go? It's not moving. I don't know what happened to the... Sorry, I don't know what happened. Okay. Okay, so now let's start discussing how we solve this problem of the two-body problem in general relativity, including, of course, radiation. So GR, as I said, is a nonlinear theory. There is a lot of complexity, similar even more than what you have in quantum chromodynamics. And there are mainly two ways in which you can solve the Einstein equation. One which is approximate, but is analytical. It's a fast way. And one which is exact, but numerical. And you solve the Einstein equation on a computer, but it's slow. And you will see that the best is coming by working at the interface between these two different approaches. And in fact, let me discuss this plot here, where on this axis you have the separation between the two objects in units of gm over c square. So if you go in this direction, large separation also means small velocity, because of the viral theory, gm over rc square is also v square or c square. This axis here is the mass ratio of the two objects. First approach that I want to just highlight is called post-Newtonian theory. So what you do is that you solve basically the Einstein equation in an expansion in v over c. So this approach was introduced actually 100 years ago by work by Drost and Lorentz, and also Einstein, Imfeld, and Hoffman. And then many people have participated in actually improving this approach. So what you do is that you expand the Einstein equation in power of V over C, or Gm over RC square. And just to give you an idea, at Newtonian, at leading order, you get, for example, for the Hamiltonian, so suppose that you go in the center of mass, so you have now the variable that describe the dynamics are just R and P, the separation and the momentum. So having put G equal to 1, and also some masses M equal to 1, you basically have Newtonian Hamiltonian, okay, what you have in Newtonian gravity. But then you start adding correction, v square over c square, and you have at 1 PN, v square over c square, a new piece of the Hamiltonian. At 2 PN, you will have you know, other corrections. So just to, I want to remind you that at 1 PN is the motion that actually predict the precession of the periastron, okay? That we know from the measurement, for example, of Mercury, etc. And in this approach, the compact objects, being neutron star or black holes, are actually represented by point-like body which are endowed with some time-dependent multiple moments that then will describe, you know, the structure of the body. And also for people here who work more in, you know, in this kind of problems, I want to say that there are actually approaches that have been also applied to solve this problem in the so-called post-Newtonian and also post-Minkowskian formalism that use so-called effective field theory approach, because there are different scales in the problem. So if these are the two bodies going around each other, you have the dimension of the two objects, capital R, the separation between them. Then, like you would do in electromagnetism, you can be at in a region of space which is very small with respect to the wavelength of the gravitational wave. This is so-called the exterior region here. You can be also in the region where the separation, I mean the distance from the source, is much larger than the wavelength of the gravitational wave. And this problem is generally solved close to the two bodies. You use the post-Newtonian approach, which neglects retardation effects. Then very far from the source, you do an expansion in G, which is this post-Minkowskian approach, and then you match the two expansion in a buffer region. Anyway, this is quite complicated, but just to give you an idea, we just produce results. Today we know the post-Newtonian equations of motion up to so-called 4PN order, which would be powers v square over c square to the power v over c to the power 8. Okay, so this is, for example, the acceleration of one of the two bodies. You recognize the leading term, maybe only the leading term, which is the Newtonian, minus gm2 divided by r square, the separation vector between the two bodies. But then you have the correction at 1 over c square, 1 to the c4. Then you have the corrections. Then you have the correction. Then you have the correction. These formulas are very long, okay? Now, the problem is that, this is very good, this expansion, and it's very good if the two bodies are not very close to each other. So at some point, this approximation starts to become less and less accurate, but as you can see from this diagram, it is valid for any mass ratio. I didn't do any approximation on the mass ratio, only an expansion in V over C or GM over RC squared. There is another way in which you can solve the two-body problem analytically or semi-analytically, which is called perturbation theory and gravitational cell force. So here, basically, what you do is that you expand in the mass ratio. So this approach goes back to work in the 50s and 70s by Reggie Wheeler, Zerilli, and Tiokoski. So the small parameter is now the mass ratio. So one body is much larger than the other. And in principle, the velocities can take any value, v square over c square. And in fact, as a first approximation, these are just geodesic, for example, in the geometry of Schwarzschild or Kerr. So if you now solve the Einstein equation under the approximation that the mass ratio is small, and you look for the equation for the perturbations, and you decouple the angular part that depends on theta and phi from time and radius, you derive this equation from the perturbation, which is called the Reggio-Wheeler equation, which has a potential here, and the term on the right-hand side, this is actually decomposed in spherical harmonic, that depends on the energy-momentum tensor. So you solve this equation with the usual methods like Green functions. Now, however, if you want to be extremely precise, you have to actually start including the back reaction due to the fact that the small mass is not negligible, but will start having some effects on the dynamics and the gravitational wave. And so you have to include these back reaction effects.
And this is called now gravitational cell force, which is quite complicated, in fact, approach with many years of work by several people. Now, this approach, however, is also valid. So if you want now, it's valid for any velocity because I didn't do an expansion in the velocity. But at some point, if the mass ratio is no longer very large, it starts to become less and less accurate. Now, one way to solve this problem completely, as I was saying, is to just solve the Einstein equation on a computer. And there was an important breakthrough, a very important breakthrough, in 2005, first by Pretorius, then by, the group by Manuela Campanelli and Lusto, and then John Baker and John Centrella, etc. And then many people also obtained the results. Here you solve the Einstein equation on a computer. Today we have catalogs of waveforms. However, although this is very precious and very important, it is very time consuming to produce this simulation. And as I will show you in a moment, in a few slides, we use actually match filtering signal processes. We have model search in LIGO that have to be used when the signals are very long and we cannot just see them by eye, detect them with unmodeled search, because the signal to noise ratio is not very large or they are very long. And so we have to use bank of templates, and to produce them with numerical relativity is very time consuming. So this is the longest simulation ever produced, 376 gravitational wave cycles, the two black holes at zero spin, the mass ratio was 7, it took 8 months, a few million CPU hours, and here you see in fact the waveforms. Okay, so we need to do something more. And so now I want to discuss this approach, which goes under the name of effective one-body approach, which was introduced before the numerical relativity breakthrough. And in the last 10, 15 years, many people have contributed to improve this approach. And this approach actually puts together analytical techniques like post-Newtonian theory and also gravitational cell force, and after the breakthrough, also numerical relativity. But it uses post-Newtonian theory not as an expansion in V over C, but as I will show you in a moment, it resums the post-Newtonian terms in a suitable way so that the dynamics can be described more accurately, even up to merger, close to plunge and merger. And this approach has also a way of analytically model the merger part and then the ring down part, as I will show you. So let me I have just a few slides. So the key idea of the approach is the following. I introduced before the reduced mass of the system and this dimensionless mass, dimensionless quantity, which is the reduced mass divided by m. So this approach does a mapping between the two-body description and an effective one-body description, in which you have an effective body, a body which has the mass, the reduced mass, that moves in an external space-time, which this space-time is just a deformation of a black hole space-time, where the deformation parameter is new, is this symmetric mass ratio. In fact, in the limit in which nu goes to zero, which is the case in which the two masses are very different from each other, one is much larger than the other, nu goes to zero, and you know the solution of the energy in this case, because this is just Schwarzschild energy or Kerr energy. But the point is that LIGO is going to see systems when the two masses can be even comparable. So we have to go away from the large mass ratio limit, and this approach does it by deforming with respect to the exact solution, which is the one of Kerr and Schwarzschild. And now let me tell you that this approach was actually inspired originally by similar idea in quantum field theory. And I show you in a moment why, in fact.
In fact, why? Let me tell you first why. Because, the problem is that we don't know what is the energy or the Hamiltonian of the system in general relativity when the two masses are equal. In the same way, in electrodynamics, if we want to study the energy, if we want to get the energy levels of a bounded system of two charged bodies, but the masses of the two bodies are comparable. Think about the positronium, for example, E plus, E minus. We don't know the answer exactly. We know if we are studying the problem, the energy level of the electron in the proton, and the proton, this is going to be the hydrogen atom, and there we know the exact formula. But if you ask the question, I want to know the energy levels when the two charged bodies have comparable masses, this question is not known exactly, even in electrodynamics. And here we are actually trying to address the same problem, but in gravity. So now, if you think a la Wheeler, this problem is completely classical, okay? But think a la Wheeler quantum mechanically, because sometimes it's useful when you want to get answers also in the classical limit. The two bodies are in a bounded orbit. So I don't have to think about energy levels, discrete ones, these are continuous, but think of them as energy levels that are labeled by the adiabatic invariant J and N. And you can work out in the two-body description what is the energy as a function of the adiabatic invariance. So you will have the rest mass of the system, the total mass, and then you can work out this up to high post-Newtonian order, in fact. Alpha is just gm mu. In electrodynamics, this alpha will be 1 over 137, by the way. In the effective description, at the beginning, you don't know what is going to be the effective metric, there will be some unknown coefficients. But then what you do is that you map the two energies with some arbitrary coefficients here, and then you identify the adiabatic invariance. So you say the adiabatic invariance in the real and effective description are the same. Now I have to find the relation between the energy. This is NR, means non-relativistic, by the way, energy. And you can solve exactly this problem for the coefficient alpha 1, alpha 2, and this coefficient here. And at the end, you find a very simple relation between the effective energy and the real energy. This was originally found at 2pn order in the first paper in 1999. Then, in the meantime, the 3pn calculation of the equations of motion in pn were done, and the problem was extended at 3pn. But it's interesting to look at this formula here. This is a paper by Bresan, Hitchinson, and Saint-Justin on 1970. They were trying to tackle this problem, actually, of the positronium, and they were trying to get the energy in an approximate way of the positronium, starting from the formula, the Balmer formula for the hydrogen atom. And now the hydrogen atom will have z equal to 1, and also you wouldn't have this epsilon j, okay? But in any case, you can see there is the same mapping. Now, this is not a proof that, you know, this is going to be valid always, when you add spins, when you have high PN orders, but it was actually giving, it was actually showing that we were on a good path, perhaps, that you know, this is a better way of getting the energy of the two-body system. And in fact, if you want a little bit more technically, with some more equations, if you think in terms of the Hamiltonian, what we are doing is that we start from the Hamiltonian expanded in post-Newtonian terms. I didn't put here 1 over c squared, 1 over c to the 4, etc. We go to this effective Hamiltonian, which is just the Hamiltonian in Schwarzschild. For people here who are familiar with the Hamiltonian for a particle of mass mu in the geometry of Schwarzschild, this is the expression in terms of p and r.
These are the potential in Schwarzschild. In Schwarzschild, this is 1 minus 2 m over r. This is the inverse of it. And now when we do this mapping that we're talking about, we get a new Hamiltonian. Instead of being post-Newtonian expand, is related to the effective one through this square root here. And the interesting thing is that the potential after this mapping is not just 1 minus 2 m over r. It gets corrections at 1 pn, and actually this is the 2 pn correction, the 3 pn correction, the 4 pn correction that is known. And you can see the dependence on u, because I told you there will be a dependence on u. And then there are higher order terms that are not known. Now, if you know the Hamiltonian, first of all, this problem was then extended to spins, so you can add that the black hole have spins now, so you can actually map to a geometry which is a deformation of Kerr. And there are actually two different EOB resummations with a spin that have been proposed. One was my group at Maryland with Enrico Barause and Etienne Racine, and the other version slightly, with some differences, but not major differences, by the group by Thibaut Damour and collaborators. I will here focus more on the Hamiltonian that we developed, because it's the one that then we used to calibrate numerical relativity and use in LIGO. So once you know the Hamiltonian, you can write down the Hamilton equations with a force on the right hand side. You can evolve also the spin using Poisson brackets here. I'm not going to go into the details how we compute the force here. Also, the waveform written in spherical harmonics can be resummed with respect to the Newtonian, the post-Newtonian expression. But the bottom line of all this is that we think we have a better, more accurate way of describing the dynamics going toward the merger, which actually agrees with the post-Newtonian theory as the two bodies go are farther apart. So this actually was, once you have the Hamilton equation, you can evolve them and you get the trajectory. These were plots taken from the original paper in 2000, where also we had an idea of how actually to complete the waveform, including also the merger and the ring down, as you can see in this plot here. So I want to describe how this was done. For people who have not maybe studied the geometry of Schwarzschild and Kerr, might not be obvious, but so outside the geometry, in the geometry of Kerr, or let's say Schwarzschild, we have what is called the innermost stable circular orbit, which is the last stable orbit after which, if you pass that, the two bodies can only plunge. They cannot stay anymore on a circular orbit. And there is also what is called the light ring, or the photon orbit, which is the unstable orbit for a massless particle. This plays an important role in the production of quasi-normal modes, because it has been shown, starting from the 70s, that when a particle crosses the light ring, basically quasi-normal modes are excited. So now, if I take the Hamilton equation and I evolve them, over the evolution, and then I pass through the ISCO, then I pass through the light ring, then I stop there, okay? So this is the waveform, and this is actually the gravitational wave frequency, twice the orbital frequency as function of time. Now, once I arrive at the light ring, I can compute the energy and the angular momentum of the system there, and I can guess that if I assume that no energy and no angular momentum is emitted after that point, which is an approximation, I can basically guess what is the mass and the spin of the final object, the black hole. And if you know that, you know the quasi-normal modes, because I told you before that the quasi-normal mode only depend on the mass and the spin. So I can guess that the mass and the spin of the final black hole are going to be the one that I can determine in this approximate way at the light ring.
And so then I'm done, because at that point I can just add a superposition of quasi-normal modes and basically merge together the final part of the spiral plunge with the quasi-normal mode signal, and I do get the complete waveform with a frequency going up like this, and then going to the least damped quasi-normal mode, okay, that you see here. Basically, this was the guess that we had, you know, in 2000. Now, of course, this is just based on analytical solution, semi-analytical solution, and so the question was, how does it compare with numerical relativity when there was the breakthrough in 2005? Okay, so first, just one thing I wanted to say. Why actually this idea of merging almost directly the spiral plunge with the quasi-normal mode part works? And here we have to go back to the work of this equation, actually, the equation of perturbation in black hole spacetime that I had before. So I showed you this equation in the case in which, in the test particle limit, when one body is much larger than the other, which, however, is this exact solution that I'm trying to have in my description, because I know that in a certain limit, I always have to go to, you know, when nu goes to zero, I have to recover that solution. So I plot here the potential around the Schwarzschild, or a black hole with zero rotation. And if you go in this direction, you go very far from the black hole. Here there is the horizon. And here, where you have the peak of the potential, is where is the light ring. And now, if you are coming, if you are a particle which is going around and then plunging and going inside and merging with a black hole, you are passing this potential. This is a problem like in quantum mechanics. This is like a Schrödinger equation. And what happens is that once the body basically goes inside the barrier, you don't, because basically you are inside the barrier acts like a high pass filter. Basically, you don't see any details of whatever happens inside the potential. The only thing that is filtered out are the quasi-normal modes. And that's why we believe that the signal, in fact, of the merger, it's very, very, first of all, it's very short, but it's very simple, because it is just basically, so as you plunge inside, then you get immediately the vibration of the space-time, and everything else is just hidden beyond the potential barrier. And so the merger signal is very simple, and that's why we can actually describe it semi-analytically. Now, however, how does it compare with numerical relativity, which has, of course, the exact solution? So the first comparison we did in 2007 with Franz Praetorius, this was a simulation that he did with the two black holes with the horizon. You can see here that go around each other. These were just a few orbits. And then this was the common apparent horizon that forms, and then the final horizon that you can see here. And this is the evolution of the frequency in this numerical relativity simulation, very similar to what you see here, you know, in this plot here. But this is now from numerical relativity, as you can see. And this was the first comparison of the model without using any extra parameter and without calibrating it, of the waveform obtained by the effective one-body approach in green and the one of numerical relativity. Of course, there are some differences because, you know, in one case this is semi-analytic, but the main idea is actually well captured. Then the model started to be improved over time. This was a calibration that was done at the time I was still at Maryland with the Goddard group, John Baker and John Centrella and Bernard Kelly, where now what we did, we started to add higher order post-Newtonian correction to the waveform and tune them to numerical relativity, and you see we can get a better agreement. So in fact, what we do today is the following. So we have, if you want, a framework that has in spiral, merge, ring down. But it's semi-analytical, we have some differences. We have numerical relativity. We use numerical relativity to improve this model so that we can provide very accurate waveform models for LIGO and Virgo.
And so the process is the following. We take a numerical simulation, which is actually in blue here, and this is just the last cycles of a simulation that lasted 60 gravitational wave cycles. So I'm looking just at the last part. The effective one-body waveform is actually in red here, and they are very close to each other, a very large separation. So at the beginning, you don't see, I didn't plot it, but then they start to deface one from the other. But as you can see, again, even the effective one-body one has the merger in down. So I want to get them closer to each other. So what we do is the following. We say we calibrate the model. And so what we technically do is that we go back to the potentials here. And these potentials are known up to a certain post-Newtonian order, today 4pn. We add some higher order post-Newtonian term that we don't know today. And we calibrate it. We basically get it or fit it by comparing with numerical relativity and imposing a very good agreement with numerical relativity up to the end. And this is the good agreement that we get. And then we improve it even a little bit more by extracting some information from numerical relativity close to merge, because our waveforms assume all the time that the two bodies are moving on a circular orbit, and this is no longer true when the two bodies are plunging. And so we extract some information from numerical relativity so that we can have a very good matching. I should say this is done with simulation with mass ratio 1, but we also use simulations of numerical waveform by solving the Tyokovsky equation, basically the equation of the perturbations that I showed you before, because it's very simple. The one I was saying, it blocked again, okay. So anyway, this is a simulation obtained by solving the equation in the test poly limit for a spin 0.99, so almost extremal. It's very little bit weird, it appears. But what I'm saying is that we basically use results from numerical relativity in the test particle limit, and we put them together so that we can cover the whole parameter space. It blocked again. I don't know what's the problem. But okay, actually move on. Okay, so this is actually the potential that I showed you before, that where we add these calibration parameters. So the new potential is in red as a function of the separation, and Schwarzschild would be here. So basically, by the strong field effects are changing the potential with respect to Schwarzschild by this amount. Okay. Okay, so in conclusion, what we do is the following, the procedure to build this waveform. So we use this Hamiltonian with spin effects that I just mentioned to you a few slides ago that we developed at the time I was at Maryland, but then also when I moved to Germany. And working with several postdocs and the people from the Simulating Extreme Space-Time Simulation collaboration, they first produced numerical relativity simulation in some point of the parameter space. This is the symmetric mass ratio, and these are the spins of the two bodies. Then we tune the model in this point of the parameter space, which means we get very good agreement between EOB effective one body and R after the calibration and the numerical relativity simulation. And then we test the model against the points, which are the one in red, where we have numerical relativity simulation that were not used to calibrate. And then we also extend the model everywhere else in the parameter space so that a template bank or a waveform can be built for any value of the masses and any value of the spin. But keep in mind that in these other regions, we don't have numerical simulation. So it's good in the future, you know, we are continue to produce more simulations so that the model can continue to be checked and improved. Now, I want to say there is also another way of building a waveform that includes the inspired merging down, which is called phenomenological. Here, the approach is different. You don't try to build it from first principle. You basically build a waveform in the frequency domain the waveform in the frequency domain is made of an amplitude and a phase. And so what they have done is to basically, if you look in the frequency domain, you have the amplitude as a certain shape during the inspiral, the intermediate region, and the merger in DAO, and the derivative of the phase as a certain shape. And so they take these ansatz with the parameters, lambda I, many parameters, and they just fit this parameter against putting together for the inspiral the effective one body, for the merger ring down numerical relativity, they build the waveform and they fit against them. It's a very effective way and very fast way of getting inspiral merger ring down signals, and you will see some plots where I talk about them. Okay, so now let's go to the detection. So now for the model search, we use match filtering. So we take the output of the detector, we correlate with the bank of templates, and this is the projection of the template bank in the mass plane M1, M2. The template bank are four dimensionals because we also have the spins of the two objects, but we allow the spins to be only aligned and perpendicular to the orbital angular momentum, because this seems to be enough to actually detect signals, because typically we could also allow precession. So this was the template bank for the first observing run. For masses above four solar masses, we use inspiral merger ring down templates from the this EOBNR templates that I was describing, 200,000. Below four solar masses, because we are not sensitive to the merger, we can use just post-Newtonian templates. And this plot shows the detection of the first two signals. And there is also this plot, which is very important because it shows basically the false alarm probability as a function of the detection statistics, or if you want, the signal-to-noise ratio. And here you see also the first event and the second event. And this is the false alarm probability that has been computed using the background noise. But actually, we built a much larger background noise because we use this technique in which we shift the data of one detector with respect to the other by multiple of 0.1 seconds, so that and then we look for coincidences which are just due to noise between them. And we didn't find any coincidence as strong as actually the one that was detected. In fact, you can see that the false alarm probability went to, I mean, it's of the order of what, maybe 20 here in terms of detection statistics, and the false alarm probability 10 to the minus 8. So this allowed us to conclude that the events were of astrophysical origin. But I should emphasize that for the first detection, even a minimal assumption search, which didn't use any templates, could reach highest detection confidence larger than 4.6 sigma, because the event, I show you the plot, was the first plot I show about the signal detected, was really very loud. Okay. This was actually for the second observing run, the template bank. Okay, I will not discuss this. So now let me say, after we made the detection, of course, we wanted also to be sure before starting or while starting to extract information like spin parameters, you know, masses, etc., the waveform models were not affected by modeling systematics in the region of the parameter space where the detection happened. And so we ran, together with other also groups, numerical relativity simulation already happened there. So this simulation was run at AI by Sergei Osokain, postdoc there as part of the SXX project. The procedure is that we first use the waveform to identify the region in the parameter space where the event happened. Then we run the simulation in that region and compare with the waveform, and we didn't find a difference, I mean a large difference, but you see there are small differences here. But a very detailed study was done to conclude
that the systematics due to modeling are actually smaller than the statistical error that is set by the signal-to-noise ratio of the detector. And this analysis was repeated also for the very long second event of the first run, because here we were worried that perhaps because the waveform is much longer, perhaps there is more disagreement with numerical relativity, because there is more phase disagreement that can accumulate for many cycles. So this was another simulation that was performed at the AI. And this was a plot taken from the paper of the second detection. You can see the reconstructed signal with the templates in gray and the numerical relativity waveform that fits very well inside. And so again, also for this, the systematics due to modeling are smaller than statistical errors. So now let's move on and now
that we believe that these waveforms are not going to give us a large systematic or any systematic error due to modeling, which information can we extract?
So there is a lot of information encoded in the waveform, spin effects, tail effects, the fact that the gravitational wave, before going to infinity, they backscatter with the geometry around the two holes. This is an effect due to the nonlinearity of gravity, and then goes to infinities are called tail effects. Also, the two black holes, their mass and spin, it's almost constant, but because they absorb some gravitational wave, actually the mass, and especially the spin, can vary a little bit. So these effects are also encoded in the waveform, of course, quasi-normal modes. And you can see from this plot, if you have a modified theory of GR, or if you have matter, for example, neutron star, the waveform is going to be different. So what we do in order to analyze and extract parameters, we apply Bayesian analysis, Bayesian techniques. We use Monte Carlo, Markov-Chain Monte Carlo analysis. So basically, we look for the templates that best fit the data. So the likelihood function for the observed data, which contain noise plus signal, given the hypothesis that there is a gravitational wave signal with certain parameter theta t, is given by this expression here, where in the exponent there is basically an integral. I didn't write the formula here, but here what you try to do, you basically minimize the difference between the data and the template. By reducing as much as possible this, you get a better agreement with the data. And in fact, what you see in this plot are, for example, for one of our detection, I think this was the one of January 2017, you see the data, and you see the best fit waveform from the templates, binary black hole in blue. And actually, if you use wavelets, so here you are not using templates from general relativity, you get the orange one. Now, the thickness in the blue curve is due to the fact that we have some degeneracy. What I mean is that there are different masses, different spins that can still match quite well the data. And in fact, to be more precise, so our waveform live in a 15-dimensional parameter space, because you have the masses of the two objects, the spins, a three-dimensional spin object for the two bodies, then the distance to the source, then you have all the angles that describe the orientation of the binary with respect to the detector, etc. They make 15 parameters. So our Markov-Chain Monte Carlo analysis is done in a multidimensional parameter space, but then at the end you can do a marginalization on some of the parameters and a projection, and you can look, for example, at the masses. So these were the masses for one of the events, gravitational wave 170104. With the two models, the full precession model is the EOBNR model, which can account for the precession of the two objects. And the effective precession model is that phenomenological model that I mentioned to you before, that can actually describe a combination of the spin. And that's why it's called effective as less degrees of freedom.
But I want just to point out that despite the differences between the two models, what really determines here the spread in our uncertainty is because these lines here are the 90% credible regions, is basically the signal-to-noise ratio of the detector. There is no much difference between the posterior distributions that you see here between the two models, but it's more, you know, the fact that we have a certain signal-to-noise ratio, and basically that is what determines the spread. And how well we can measure the masses. This is actually the very recent event that maybe went didn't make a big splash in the news, because this came out after even the binary neutron star, which is the one detected in June, the 8th of June, that came out in October. And it was actually the binary black hole for which the component masses went to the lower values of possible of the mass, I mean, at least among the ones that have been observed. So this is the other one. Let me skip this. I want to say something about precession. So until now, so we have been able actually to say something about the magnitude of the spins of the two black holes, but not much about whether the spins of the black holes are precessing or they are just aligned and perpendicular to the orbital plane. And I want to show you, in fact, that the parameters that describe the spins that we measure the best, so the one that we measure the best, is the projection of the spin along the direction of the orbital angular momentum. And this parameter that we call chi-effective, the posterior distribution is shown here for the two models, the EOBNR and the IMR phenomenon. Okay? So one is full precession and the other is effective precession. Now, the posterior distribution with 90% credible region is centered around zero. So this is consistent. The two spin could also be zero, but could be different from zero. But this other posterior distribution represent actually the spins, is the projection of the spin on the orbital plane. And the prior is in green. And you can see the two posterior distribution are not very different from the prior. So this says that, in fact, we don't have a lot, we cannot say much about precession. And this was true also for this other event, which was the very long 55 gravitational wave cycles, where again, we cannot say much about precession. One of the reasons, let me go to this slide here, is because these events are not very long signals. In order to see a precessional effects would modulate the signal in time. So you wouldn't have only gravitational emission at twice the orbital frequency, but you will have on top some modulations. But you see this modulation if you are seeing the binary not face on or face off, but if you see it inclined. And unfortunately, for the event that we have seen, we actually can compute the inclination of the orbit with respect to LIGO. And we found that for all the events that we have seen, this is actually mainly either face on or face off, but certainly not inclined. And by the way, this is also is expected because the strongest signal, gravitational wave signal, comes in the direction perpendicular to the orbital plane. So the fact that we are seeing these signals is also, we are maximizing the signal to noise ratio if we see the binary, face on or face off. So what I want to say in this plot is that if you have a non-precessing binary, let's say with mass ratio 4, for some values of the spin, K1, K2, if you look it face on, this will be, the signal. If you look it edge on, this will be the signal for non-precessing. If it is precessing, if you continue to see the signal face on, you see there is no much difference between the two plots, But there is a difference if you were seeing, you know, the signal H on, which is not, you know, what we are seeing. And in fact, this plot is also interesting because it says, if you look at it, it's changing, even if slightly. And it's a movie done by Williamson and collaborator. It shows the fact that we have degeneracy in the parameters, that if you change a little bit the spins, if you change a little bit the mass ratio, for example, we cannot discriminate. And this is what causes also the thickness in the curve. And the, you know, when you see the 90% credible region spanning a large region in the mass and the spin, it's telling you. Okay, so how much time I have? Zero. So then I will maybe say something about testing GR a few slides later this afternoon before starting to discuss the binary neutron star. So I stop here and I get questions. Yeah.
Very short question. The first on the effective of one body.
Yeah. Ah, you need a microphone, but they are not working. They are not working.
Doesn't work.
Works. According to the effective one body, is it possible to expand more? In the sense that considering, for example, also loops in the electrodynamics analogies that you are doing,
yeah.
It would be very useful for quantum gravity and so on, for example.
Now I don't know what do you refer by loops, but I should say that
loops in the series. When you have in electrodynamics, you have a three level and then so on.
Yeah, yeah.
It could be possible also.
Yes, but in fact, when people apply the effective field theory approach to tackle the post-Newtonian problem, you can do. A diagrammatic expansion of the gravitational problem also using loops. And so what I'm trying to say is that when you start adding a post-Newtonian correction at high order, you do have the loops. So maybe I didn't have it in my diagrammatic, but just because I was using the first diagrams there. The approach can be extended at high post-Newtonian orders or high post-Minkowskian orders also, which means GM over RC square. It's an expansion in G instead of V over C. Yeah.
I was wondering, since you said that your calculation had 15 parameters. The error that you were showing, do they involve the uncertainty on everything, including the distance and so on? Because there have been debates about the maximum mass that the gravitational waves are suggesting for this stellar black hole.
I have here the plots of the distance. First of all, this is done all together, all the parameters together. So when you, the uncertainty of one parameter will affect also, because there are correlations. So in this plot, for the first event, for example, you see the posterior distribution of the distance. The distance we don't measure very well. In fact, 400 megaparsec, but it can go up to 200, up to 600. But it's not a factor. I think what you are referring to is that the distance is degenerated with the so-called shear mass. And so if you don't know it very well, it will affect also the determination of the masses. But the masses are also actually, let me explain this in this way. So the signal is actually inversely proportional to the distance. And then there is also the dependence on the mass there. But the mass also enters the phase. So in fact, we get the mass, the best determination of the mass comes from the phasing of the waveform, not from the amplitude. The distance only enters the amplitude. And by the way, you see also the distance here in this other, for the other detection, and I think I have also this plot here. It's even for, you know, this one, which was the 170104, you can see, you know, the large uncertainty on the distance. Okay, are there other questions? Ah, yes.
Yep, so I...
Okay, you can shout.
Okay. So, well, I don't know if it's too technical for the discussion, but my question is related to the library, right? And its relation with the random, right? The random beings are universal, right? So I get that from numerical relativity, you can basically know where is the position of this library, right? Okay. But then when you decompose the signal, that you have more modulation as higher modes, overtones, or so, you see that they affect, for instance, at different times, right? So there is a minimal shift. They are not all considered, right? So what would be a way of knowing these excitation times for
different modes? Yeah, okay. So yes, in fact, it is an open question. When you start moving away from the dominant mode, so what he's referring to is that, first of all, just to give a little bit more background to the people, so the two polarization, H plus and H cross, can be decomposed in spherical harmonics. And when you do that, the dominant one is the 2-2 mode, L equal 2, M equal 2. And the leading dominant mode has a peak close to the light ring of the system. So what he's saying is that it was then noticed that when you look at other modes, for example 2-1, 3-3, 4-4, etc., they don't peak all at the same time. And actually, I should say, I've been also working on this, I have until now not understood the physics behind where, why those other modes don't peak at the same position. In the test particle limit, where we can solve the Joukowsky equation or the Reggie-Williams, actually this problem is there, especially when you add spin. You can see from the numerical result that the peaks happen at different times, but I was not able to explain why, and I don't think nobody in the literature, I didn't see any explanation. And even in numerical relativity, I mean, you can, again, plot them, but there is no understanding. So it will be good to shed light on this. If you knew the time shift, then this can be applied. At the moment, what we do is that we take the results from numerical relativity and we compute them for different mass ratio spin, and then we produce a fit, and we put the fit in the model so that we can reproduce it. But from first principle, I don't know, I cannot explain the shift.
So you don't see the
No, no, I don't see, no, because we do this reformation of the waveform, but we don't predict the peak very well.
Okay.
Yeah, it will be very interesting, actually. It will help the modeling.
I think I had a similar question to Gabriel, but I don't know of course, it's clear that your models reproduce quite well the general Fisher of the true signal, but I want to understand, what do you do exactly to get, when you say correct, I correct.
Oh, the calibration.
The calibration, what do you do exactly?
Yeah. So what we do, yes, I'm sure that I went very fast because there is so much information in this. So what I was saying is that, so first of all, let me go back to this thing here. So once I know the Hamiltonian, and I also have a way of describing the radiation reaction force in the Hamilton equation, I solve, so is it clear? So I solve this Hamilton equation, which is faster than doing a numerical relativity simulation, okay? It is also time consuming. We have to do something to speed it up, etc. But I don't want to enter in that now. But anyway, it's faster than solving a numerical relativity simulation. Now, this Hamiltonian depends on the potential that enter the metric, the default metric in Schwarzschild OCR. And this potential I can compute as long as I know post-Newtonian theory at higher order, I can compute this potential. But post-Newtonian theory today is known up to a certain order. So then what I do is that I add unknown coefficients here at higher PN order, for example 5PN, because it's known out of 4PN. So that's a coefficient. And then what I do is that I compare with numerical relativity by basically taking take one numerical simulation in one part of the parameter space. I produce with this Hamilton equation, and then I have also a model for the waveform. I produce my EOB waveform, which is in red, dash red, and I have the numerical relativity waveform. At the beginning, I compare them, the amplitude and the phase, and they are very close to each other. You see here only the last part, but as they approach merger, they start differing. So then I add this post-Newtonian unknown higher order term, and I tune it. I impose that at merger, they have to be as much as possible close. So I reduce the phase difference, the amplitude difference at merger. And by doing that, you can get the best fit for this parameter that I added. Now, we don't add only one parameter, because when we have spin effects, we have more than one parameter. But we are adding higher order post-Newtonian terms in the model and tune them to numerical relativity to improve. Because you see, this difference will still allow you to detect the signal. Because when you detect, you are not asking very good parameter estimation. You can get the signal, you can detect the signal with the wrong parameters, but you still detect it. But if you want to extract then the masses and the spins, if you want to reduce the uncertainty in the parameter, you have to have a better waveform, and so you have to go, you know, to this. Basically, this is what, in a very simple way, we do.
So this technique allows you to fix in the standard, let's say, view of general relativity, the feature of the source. Let's say. I cannot allow you to say something, to test predictions beyond general relativity.
Actually, that was what I'm going to discuss this afternoon. But you can, because you see, if you have a model, a waveform model, that you start from analytical, you include this information from NR, and then you check against NR, which is the exact solution of the two-body problem in GR, then you have a very faithful model, and now you can start looking at deviation from GR. So in fact, what I will show this afternoon is that you can allow some parameters to be not the GR values, and you can look at possible deviation from GR. You can do that. Of course, you are sure that you are doing the right thing if you are in the region of the parameter space where this work of calibrating to NR is accurate. If you don't know that you have a model close to GR, then you can certainly not test non-GR. But we will see this afternoon something about this. Okay? There is another question.
Can you explain this analogy between what you and the Gaussian effect of quantization?
Okay, the analogy is just that, so this is, as I said, a completely classical problem. And like even the two-body problem in Newtonian gravity, you can use the Hamilton-Jacobi formalism to solve for it. No? You can determine the adiabatic invariant N and J and write it. In fact, the leading order term, this term, is basically Newtonian gravity, this term here. So here, the analogy is just to say that if you think about the Bohr analog, Deboratom case. So how do you relate this effective and real description? You can say that when you quantize, N and J are going to be multiple of H bar. And you can do that in the real description, in the effective description. And then, you know, it's natural, I mean, maybe for you it's not natural, but it's natural to think that because they are multiple of H bar, when you try to identify the two descriptions, you just identify this N with this N and this J with this J. So you are identifying the adiabatic invariance of the two descriptions, but you are allowing the energy to basically be mapped in a, you know, in this case in a more arbitrary way, because alpha 1, alpha 2 can be whatever coefficient here. So you will determine them, because what you do is that if you identify N and J, then in this formula you plug E effective from here, you plug E real, this is non-relativistic, you are getting rid of the first term here, and then you obtain a certain number of equations in unknown, in powers of 1 over N square, 1 over NJ, you identify and you get all these parameters. But you have to give a prescription of how you identify N real, J real, with N effective, J effective. And you say they are, you know, multiple of H bar, you just identify them, but it's just this. I don't know if you are satisfied by my answer, but.
So, maybe for the session, we can stop here, thank you, speaker, and you were short, maybe at 2:30.
Ah, 2:30, okay.